हेलो सर।
हाँ यस
एक्चुअली मोस्ट ऑफ अस डोंट नो हाउ टू यूज मैटलैब, एंड लाइक इफ यू कुड शेयर मतलब सम बिगिनर वीडियोस और सम ट्यूटोरियल्स फॉर दैट, एट दैट वुड बी हेल्पफुल।
ओके बट डिडेंट आई सेंड द कोड्स फर्स्ट वीक क्लासेस कोड्स लाइक द मिक्सर असेंबली प्रॉब्लम सेवरल टैंक्स इंटरकनेक्टेड. इफ यू रन दैट कोड यू विल गेट एन आइडिया अबाउट हाउ टू प्रोसीड. एटलीस्ट बिफोर यू रन द मैटलैब फर्स्ट थिंग इज टू सेट अप द इक्वेशंस राइट. So as I was explaining the mixer assembly problem that you have to set up the equations in the form of AX equals to B. So there will be several. So basically A is a matrix, X is a vector, column vector, and B is also a column vector, right?
Yes,
So
sir.
that form you have to first arrive by writing the governing equations. So first step is to write the governing equations across each tray, not only across each tray, but also at the absorber and entry point and exit point. So based on this, you have to first develop the equations. If you remember the same strategy that we had used in information flow diagram is that we have to first set up the equations, then we have to use those equations to put it in the form of the block diagram. So first step is always this set up the equations. Now, provided the fact that the process is known to you, even if it is not known, but there should be sufficient informations from which you can write the basic chemical engineering laws. For example, the overall mass balance, the species balance, the enthalpy balance. So these are the basic steps in order to first progress. So if you just open up the absorber column problem, N plate absorber column, so the similar situation occurs. You have to set up the balance across all the stages and at the entry and exit. So typically you have an idea about absorber, right? A solute that is present in gas, it has to be absorbed in the liquid. So the liquid that is entering into the top is pure. That means X0, which is the solute concentration, that is zero. In fact, it is also given here that liquid entering is pure. And gas entering has a composition 0.2 kg mole solute per kg mole inert. So that gas enters from the bottom. GYN plus 1 is its compositions. So N is given as 6. So it will accordingly you modify the diagram and you set up the equation. So basically you have to just simply put it as mass in equal to mass out. So with that you have to all you have to do just try. If not working then I'll be there, but you have to first initiate it. Just try it first on your own. At least develop the equations first, few equations. How the nature of the equation? What is the nature of the equations like that? Okay. Definitely, I'll be showing the MATLAB applications, but at least that is just the execution part, but development of the model equations are major thing. So how do you write the equations? First one at the top tower entry or any across any plate? So what is happening across each plate in the gas liquid contactor, gas liquid observer column? Across each stage, what is happening? Please respond. We have to proceed.
Like the liquid, there is absorption at each phase because of the liquid and the gas contact.
That is fine. So can you draw the can you write the equations if you have a gas phase, if you had liquid phase, and you have the solute which is present in both the phase.
We can
So
like on doing material balance, you get Yn plus 1 minus Y1 is equal to L by G into Xn minus X0.
very good. So this is the major equations that you have to repeat it across each tray and also at the tower entry and tower exit. So do it. I'll just show the formulation part, but I wanted you to do it now. I don't know how many of you have tried, but you can expect that similar cases will be appearing for other for this kind of problem, not only the observer but also extraction column and N stage extraction column. So just giving you some idea that basically this is what happening. It is across the typical tray. If we write it, then it is like this, and then just we have to write the mass in equals to mass out. That is, we are making a balance across the solute. And then we have to also make use of the linear equilibrium relations, that is relating the two streams which are in equilibrium, that is the leaving stream from the tower from the across each tray. That means the gas stream which leaves and liquid streams also which leaves, which we use as a case at the equilibrium driven process. So the leaving streams are in equilibrium, the rate is governed by equilibrium. So Yn and Xn, there is a equilibrium relations which is also given here. So just substitute it and you will get this kind of equations. So you will have this sort of equations where other coefficients will be zero in the coefficient matrix and sum of and the diagonal and off diagonal will be non-zero. So and then your B vector, that is the what is called the constant matrix vector, are like this. And then you have to just simply use the set of parameter values, that is A, B, G, and L, to calculate X. And if you do the inverse matrix, you will find that since this is totally interconnected, that means each of these stages or tray, they experience or they are getting affected by the change in previous tray. So there will be no there all the coefficients or all the elements in the coefficient matrix, inverse matrix, it will be non-zero. So that is the checking that we can also do by just simply typing the inverse. Now coming to the MATLAB, it is just you have to write the lines. Even if you can do it in command window itself, or you can also write the MATLAB code in the M file. So here that is the single MATLAB file will be required. No more function is required. So just to show you that you can directly make use of the command window where you can simply write and some mathematical lines to calculate and execute. So the results will be appearing in the command window, and this is like the editor window where you have to write several function file or the main file. So here I have just basically written the input parameters, the liquid flow rate, gas flow rate, the concentration of solute at the liquid and concentration of gas which is entering in the tower. So these are the known inputs. So outside or exit concentrations, that is the concentration of solute in the living liquid and concentration of solute in the gas that is leaving the tower, they are unknown, and they will be obtained from the mass balance. So that those are basically x6 and y7. So this is how we basically write. First we define the coefficient matrix as just a blank matrix or nothing but containing all the elements as zero, and then we are populating them by writing the coefficient terms. So which you can also make use of a loop, and but in that case you have to make ensure that at the these two are different. So at at the tower entry and tower exit, you have different matrix values or different coefficient values, and other cases it is the same. So just go through these lines, you will be easily able to solve the you will be able, easily able to get the answers of the concentration across each tray. And if you see the inverse matrix, the elements are all of elements are non-zero, and that also makes sense because each tray is getting affected by the previous tray or the next tray. In fact, the tray nth tray is getting affected by the change in n minus 1th tray, like this. So this is how we get we can solve this kind of problem. And there are other couple of exercise assignment problems. In fact, three problems I'll be giving as an assignment to you after the end of this class. So those will contain making some of IFD and make use of nonlinear algebraic equations, which we were discussing yesterday. So are there any doubts from the nonlinear algebraic part, which we discussed yesterday?
So how to make block diagram for this?
Good, how to make block diagram. Now, for particular this kind of problem, you have just input at the input side. You have the L, G. These are the input values. So if you make a block diagram, what would be it look like? Let us try. I will have some blank pages. Let me see if I can. Maybe I can draw here, but I want input from your side. So this problem is just a linear algebraic equations. We don't have to take much of the we don't have to face much difficulty. So what you can achieve, you can make use of a single block, because the inputs are remain the same. Because if you see the coefficients matrix nature, it is basically the these equations. So in general, we can write it as this is our main governing equation, which actually changes with changing plate to plate. So what is our main governing equation? The governing equation is this. Now this can be easily substituted to get rid of y, and that we have exactly done here. So this is our main equations, right? So this equation you can enter. And as the principles of making IFD tells us, that the variables that we want to find out should be kept in the left. Now here, basically all are interconnected. So just by taking these block equations or taking this equation and pasting it here, just a single equation, and then you can make use of i equal to 1, 2, or i equal to 1, 2, i equal to 6. So this is the single step. I mean, for this problem, you don't have to take much difficulty. So you have the L, you have the G, you have X0, these are all input. And because the moment you write the single equations, or you can also write the 7 equations inside this big block diagram, and where you will easily find that either the coefficients of the equations or the constant matrix elements, they involve either this, either one of these, or maybe the combination of this thing, L, G, X0, Y7, A and B. So A and B are the constant parameters of the equilibrium relations. These two are the solute concentration at the absorber entry and absorber exit, and these are the flow rates, which is constant across the tower. So these are your input, and your output are actually many, because first equations has three unknowns, but they are actually the, they actually represent nothing but the x, which actually varies from tower to tower, stages to stages. So that's why we are writing many equations. But in these circumstances, you will get only the only, you have to make use of only one block. And further, you can, what you can do after calculating x, you can maybe you can make another block to calculate the y, and you just write the equilibrium relations, that is y equals to ax plus b, to calculate the y, because here x will be your input, and a and b are already known, so you can calculate the y. So this is relatively easy than the other cases. Okay, so any other questions from yesterday and day before that, first two classes?
Sir, the inputs are always supposed to be constant, or can they be variables also in a block diagram?
Yes, definitely, they can be variable. For example, in the first class, we have seen that they are has to be solved simultaneously. For example, if you remember the tank in tank problem, which are where the flows are governed by the valve operations, and there we have seen that in that case you can have three, four state variable, which actually characterizes the process. And it is not that each of the state variable will be calculated consecutively. So they can be they have to be solved simultaneously, not one after another. So in that case, your one variable which is being or which is acting as an input can be solved from some other block, which where that is an output. So that arrow, you have to make use of that arrow or connections, that the output of this block diagram will act as an input of this block diagram. But it has to make a logical sense, that we have also discussed, that instead of using a numerical differentiation, we have to use numerical integrations. So make sure that the one you are actually calculating can be computationally stable by making use of proper proper process, proper technique. So one after another solution, or one after another may not be possible, because equations are coupled and interconnected. But for example, algebraic equations and ordinary differential equations has to be solved in that exact way. But you cannot just simply, for example, in a differential equations, you may have a algebraic expression involved. But in order to find that algebraic values or the state variables which are appearing in the algebraic term, you cannot make use of differentiation first. So you have to make use of numerical integration. So just refer to the day one, that IFD three cases that we discussed, and that you look at that particular where we discuss the natural ordering term, where we have used the cause and effect relations. So that particular examples you just look at again, and you will understand that how to make IFD. In fact, the assignment problem that I am giving today has one question, which is basically making use of IFD. Okay, so you want a repetition of that natural ordering that thing? Yes, no?
Yes, I mean, like, in if you can give an example, so
So example means that problem can be just quickly discussed, just to clear some of if you have some doubts. So let's see. So this was the case where we were looking at the construction of information flow diagram. So see, this tank height are a function of the flow rates, right? So when we write this kind of equations, so the inputs are definitely F1 and F2, right? Now it can so happen that some of the inputs are not exactly explicit in nature. They are coming from somewhere else. So what can be one of them or can be one such thing is that, for example, this just look at this block diagram, that model one, the particular case. Now remember what was the difference? The difference is basically this flow are now governed by this valve, right? So there is a pressure differential across each valve. So those are the some extra equations that we are getting, not only the equations that governs the height of the tank, but also the equations that governs the flow rates, which is a differential pressure across this valve, square root of the pressure difference. So so for example, so in keeping in that in mind, now if we focus here, what do we see? We see that again, these equations will be the similar. In the previous case, this was not there. These two things were not there. This there was nothing. So apparently, F1 and F2 were some values which were obviously not equal, but some constant values. So we could easily integrate it with respect to time. But here now you can see F1 and F2 are also being calculated by the pressure differentials. Now in the pressure differential block, so that means we now have two more equations that characterizes F1 and F2. So they are coming from some other equations. So the output of this block acting as an input to this block. So that is that should be kept in mind. And not only that, this calculations of F1. So the one, the expressions that you write, whether it's algebraic or whether it is a differential expression, the output or the state variable must be on the right hand side, because that is the one you are going to calculate, and that is the one you are also getting from these equations. And the difference in pressure term has to be known, of course, because this P1, or even if that in that case, as I said, this P2 is not known. But P2 must be obtained from some other equations. So here it is acting as input, but from some equations we should be getting that P2 value. So what is that equation? So equation is this, where we are also getting Z. Now, these whole three equations are, as I said, are not very explicit. They are interconnected, they are coupled, but this makes a proper sense that we are making use of numerical integrations. We are making use of first calculating F1 and F2, then we are calculating Z, and that gives us the value of P2, which is used again. And so this is a kind of loop, or this is a kind of physically, it makes us a sense that it has to be calculated simultaneously, not consecutively. But these other model may be acceptable, but they are having some problem in the sense that it is not a very easy to follow diagram or naturally ordering sequence, or you have to use of numerical differentiation rather than integration. So usually we are used to with this kind of expression where we know that we have to integrate it and we have to get Z. But instead of that, we are asking that F2 should be found out from these equations. Now, in that case, if you have to calculate F2, then you cannot integrate it. You have to just differentiate this, so which is a difficulty. So this is why this information flow diagram not only has to be made just by connecting the blocks, but it has to be also made by maintaining a cause and effect relationship or kind of natural ordering. Okay, so this more and more you practice. So this Ramirez book has several examples carried out or calculated. I mean, this is given in the text. So you just go through them. You will get fair enough idea about how to make information flow diagram. And some of the example problem you can also try on your own to calculate in MATLAB and just practice it, because these codes are can be easily implemented. In fact, there is you don't have to change anything. You can just directly type it and see whether it runs or not. All right. Or any other questions? So the assignment problem which I'll be giving, just I'll show you this thing so that you get an idea about what kind of problem I'll be giving it in the form of assignment. Okay, so basically this is a mixing vessel where in the first case there is no reaction happening, in the second case there is reaction happening. So two IFT you have to make for each cases, right? So this is one problem that I have given. The second is basically the one we discussed yesterday about making use of nonlinear algebraic equations by using either epsilon or epsolve. So you have to calculate the vapor split or vapor fractions of the stream and mole fractions, that is the flash operations, and the parameters are obtained from here, that is some data are given. And the third is basically equilibrium calculations, thermodynamic equilibrium calculations, that is the mole fractions, or I think I have asked for mole fractions, equilibrium compositions in terms of mole fractions, maybe I write mole fractions. So these three questions I have given, and except the first one, the other two will make use of MATLAB files or MATLAB coding. So you have to submit the answers in not only the answer files in PDF, but along with the MATLAB files. So I'll post this as assignment after the class, along with some other necessary study materials covering yesterday and today's class. Okay. Any doubts till so far, and then we can move to the topic that we wanted to discuss today. You can ask if you have any doubts over yesterday and day before that class. But you have to practice, otherwise let me tell you very clearly, this course apparently looks simple, but you unless you practice the several questions in during exam, you will run into problem, because time will be limited and you have to do the set up the governing equations. You may be making use of IFD, and then after that you have to solve for one particular case. So practice the questions that are given in assignment as well as in the Ramirez book. Okay, now I'll move to this what is called multiple steady state problem. Okay. So how to make use of or rather how do we analyze the different steady states, and what are their physical meaning, what do we mean by that, and why we are interested in knowing them, not only just for the sake of calculations that we got some several steady state, but what they actually mean, and whether we can operate the reactor or how do we operate the reactor? So these are the some of the questions that we are asking, that what do they mean, that multiplicity of steady states. Second is why do they occur. Third is if they have occurred, that three cases that we are getting three solutions, and all are making sense. It is not that you have got some solutions which are like temperature or time, you have got negative values, so you are obviously discarding those values. But no, all are making sense. Within the physical range, you have got all the values. So which one is correct? The obvious question will come to our mind, that whether all of them are correct or any one of them are correct, like that. And since it is a reactor, so which typically, as we know, that in a steady state CSTR or PFR, what we get in case of only isothermal operations, you get outlet conversions or concentration. And if it is a non-isothermal operations, then you get temperature at the CSTR outlet, or in case of PFR, the temperature varies across the length, like that. So non-isothermal operations are more common. In fact, hardly any operations are done in industry as isothermal manner. So one should definitely understand, not only from the reaction engineering point of view, but from the process modeling point of view, because the reactor design inherently takes into account of solving the simultaneous equations, which actually relates the transport of species, the flows, the flow equations, as well as the kinetic equations. So that invariably gives us indications that you have several equations which you have to solve together to calculate the temperature, to calculate the conversions, or to calculate the velocity, right? So these are the elementary steps, or these are the elements if you think it in terms of a process simulation course. So just one chunk from that is the reactor operations, that is the CSTR operations in a non-isothermal manner. So these are the questions, as if you remember the questions that we have asked. So mainly we will focus on the results part, the occurrence, why do they occur, and if they have occurred, what are their nature, whether we accept all of them, or if slight deviations from that, whether we are able to restore the steady state, or we are not able to restore, that means the reactor temperature and conversions are way off than we expected if it were operating under steady state manner. So thermal runaway of reactor, if you have heard about this term, thermal runaway of reactor, that is nothing but the due to the slight change in the temperature and pressure, temperature and concentrations or conversions, which supposed to be at the steady state value. But if slight perturbations or slight change that has happened around the steady state, then the reactor will behave in very different manner. So if that happened, then what was the cause? So in order to know that, we must study the transients phenomena and consequently the multiple steady states analysis. So that is the main thing I wanted to give you as an introduction, that don't consider this as just the reaction engineering or reactor case as a calculations of temperature and conversion. But in a bigger manner, if you can visualize that, suppose propylene oxide, I think the one example I can show you that here, I'll give this exam numerical thing as an analysis part or for your exercise part. So this typically this production of propylene glycol. So this is a very useful chemical intermediate or chemical compound that is used that is produced by adiabatically in a CSTR. So that actually is obtained by reacting propylene oxide and water. And this is a liquid phase reactions, which is exothermic, and carried out in CSTR. Now, here also you will find that the case of multiple steady state occurred. So that is the why we of course study this topic in the process computer aided process engineering course, just to see that what are their implications, what do the results values means, and whether we at what steady state we should operate the reactor so that we do not encounter any thermal runaway. So let us proceed, let us start that part. So okay, let us just see a couple of okay. Deepak is there? Maybe he's not there. Okay.
Anyways. Yes, sir.
Oh, Deepak is there. I'll send the attendance. Just download. I'm downloading the attendance file now, and you just silently you take the attendance. Don't need to call out the names. Just silently you take. Okay. Okay, so coming back to the this equations that we actually encounter here are basically CSTR operations, which is in a non-isothermal manner. So as you know, this is a non-isothermal case, so you have both mass balance as well as energy balance, right? So these equations that we have written here, you can consider for a first order irreversible reactions, A going to R or A going to S, whatever you can call as a product species. So this first we write in terms of the text or rather the concept that we have understood, that accumulation equals to inlet minus output plus minus disappearance or generation term. So in terms of mass balance, so this is the approach as we typically write, that V dCa dt equals to Fa naught, which is the molar flow rate in minus molar flow rate out minus the rate of reactions, which is nothing but V into Ra, right? So this is the first equations that we write for mass balance. And then after that, we actually solve or substitute it, and because Fa, that is the molar flow rate, is nothing but the volumetric flow rate multiplied by the concentrations. So A or Fa, this stands at the outlet or the reactor concentrations, because it is a completely starved tank. So concentration at the exit and in the reactor inside the reactor and at the exit, they are the same. So Fa and Fa naught, if you substitute accordingly, you will get these expressions, tau A equals to this. Let me just erase this again. So you will get this tau dCa dt equals to Ca and this. So, and rate, as we know, that equals to K into Ca, but now K is a function of temperature. So that is the major characterization of non-isothermal operations, because otherwise we can assume K to be constant, but it here K is a function of temperature. And similarly, if you write the energy balance term, you will also get this thing, that this is a MCP dt and dt and dt. So basically d temperature, d time. So accumulations term equals to inlet minus output. So these two together these two together is written here. So it is basically with respect to a reference temperature and then T0 minus T. So T0 is your reactor inlet temperature. That means the feed stream that is coming in is having a temperature T0, right? So it has to be heated, or it has to be heated, and the temperature it is bringing in and the temperature with which it leaves out is basically the these expressions. So net rate of heat out from the reactor. So this is these expressions. Now that is the reaction heat. Because of the exothermic reactions, we get this as the generation term. That means this much heat is generated inside the reactor, which is and that is being utilized by two cases. One is the reactant stream, which is taking some flow out, as well as the cooling by the jacket or cooling coil. So this is the term, that is Q. So Q actually heat that is going out. So what are the then different terms that are involved? One is the net rate of heat flow out, and then heat out due to cooling across the coil or across the jacket, and the reaction heat, which is the generation term. So the overall accumulation term equals to a algebraic sum of all this. And then there was also WS, which is the mechanical work or shaft work, which is typically ignored because the other term dominates. So we don't make use of this term much. So these two major equations, as you can see here, though it looks like differential equations because we are in general considering the transient case or unsteady state, and then gradually we will go to the steady state analysis. So are these two formulative equations clear? Why they have written like this? Do you have doubts over these equations? Okay, I assume that you have understood it. So these two equations then further leads us to the further states. So this some simplifications we have done it, some divided by rho v, Cp and etc. to introduce that two different term, because we mainly our intention is to characterize the steady state, but for that we are gradually proceeding. But we are more familiar to deal or write equations not in a very clumsy manner. Rather, we try to sometimes make use of non-dimensionalization to gain some advantages. And also, the equations look much simpler, and you can easily increase or decrease in terms of the magnitude of that term. So manipulation. So you can actually manipulate the term and make use of this dimensionless of the term. So what we have used is that we have introduced just divided by rho Cp and volumetric flow rate. So just then this term generated a parameter called tau. And this is how it is written. So J is basically a dimensionless rate of heat generations, and K is also a dimensionless heat transfer coefficient. Okay, so these two are basically, as you can understand, these are constant. These are nothing but constant. So our resulting equations now. Resulting equation means resulting energy balance equation now look like this. Tau dT dt equals to this difference in temperature plus this J tau rate of reactions, which is a function of conversion and temperature, right? If it is a non-isothermal case that we usually do, then temperature is not a function of that rate. So our rate is not a function of temperature. But here we have considered non-isothermal case. So this is the nature of this expression, and this is the resulting equations. Now, what will happen that we make use of zero at the steady state, we considered that this thing. So we are interested to particularly calculate the value of t and the value of x. That means our intention is to find out tx and xs, or if you write ss as steady state. So this is what we have to find out. But we are still at the page of, or we are still at the stages of this energy balance equations, right? But you can see that there are two unknowns. One is t and one is x. So you have to solve simultaneously, right? Two equations. So what is the other equations? As we have initially set up the mass balance equations of the species. So that actually comes here. And this expression is like this. We have, again, make use of steady state. So this term is vanished. And Ca naught minus Ca equals to tau. C minus C naught equals to tau, and the way typically it is written. So basically we will get this kind of expression. And this is our second expression, or if you call it as first expression. And so these are our major two equations, X and T, which you have to find out. Now one can, at this stage, one can easily solve it and see that X and T have multiple values. X and T will have multiple values. So, or it can have a single values. So that is why sometimes you can have multiple steady states, sometimes you can have a single value of steady state. So let us further proceed, go and go ahead. Where is the origin, or where do they originate? So the case that we are going to handle or understand is that. So one thing that we are now clear is that we have developed the equations. We know that we have to find out the steady state temperature and conversions, but whether they are single valued or they will have multiple values, that is the questions. So we are proceeding further. So what we have now carried out, that using two equations, now what we are doing, that we are again taking use of the first equations here, and we are just substituting this rate term, right? This R of X and temperature. So this red term we are just writing in terms of these conversions. So these two equations, we are substituting the rate expression, rate R, and we are getting these equations. T minus T0 plus K this by J equals to XT. So what is the characterization, or what is the nature? You can, just by single equations, you can connect these two state variable, which is the conversion and temperature, right? So these equations, instead of solving, or by nature of these equations, you cannot solve it analytically, right? You maybe have to take some different approach, like graphical solutions or something. So there are two ways of analysis I will discuss now. One is the graphical, to give you a more physical picture about what do we understand if we deviate from the steady state and the stability of the steady state. And one is the mathematical one, so, or rather analytical one. So here we will more understand about the magnitude of the eigenvalues, which will tell us that whether the reactor will operate at that point, at that steady state point, stably, in a stable manner, or unstable manner. So that is why both the analysis is very important. This will give you more physical picture about, you will understand about the behavior of the process. And and this mathematical analysis will tell us about the magnitude, which you can further make use in terms of plotting the results. So we will touch upon both the thing. Achha, up to this point, it is clear to all of you? This is clear to all of you, these expressions? Yes, no.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Please feel free to ask if you have doubts. Okay. So this book is nothing but a very basic chemical engineering book, but by L.D. Smith. I'll send this particular chapter, but you can also study this as a reaction engineering book. I find this book very useful to be as each of this mathematical expression has been explained in a detailed way. Of course, Fogler and this Lebensmittel are there, but this multiple steady state part is very neatly written in this book. So that's why I have taken this particular chapter from this book. Okay, now going ahead. So why this study again, this if you read these lines, you will have a more visualization about this thing that we have now got rid of rate, but we are now arriving at a single equations, but where it is basically a t versus x, right? T versus x, because tc and j, these k, these are all constant, so it is basically t versus x, this kind of functions, right? It's basically functions, but both the unknowns are t and x. So one approach is, of course, as you can easily understand, this is a graphical, so you assume or you over a range of t, you actually can solve it for x. So what we will do here, we just we'll take a graphical approach, and see the physical picture, and then we will discuss the mathematical picture. So this these lines, as I was asking you to read, and basically in case of CSTR, you get very peculiar behavior. Unlike it is a PFR or PFR case where there is a differential equations which will have a unique solutions for a specified reaction inlet parameters and flow properties, but in case of PFR you may get different behavior. So that's why this is the main task that we are doing it here. Now in the previous exam expressions, if you see, you can just also make use of this term as one term. This is, so these are all basically flow out, or not flow out, the heat out term, right? These are all basically heat out term, summation of these two. In fact, if you just divide it as T minus T0 by J, you can have two terms together plus K minus K into T minus TC by J. So what is the physical meaning of these two terms? If you see that this is basically the temperature or difference by and this actually represents the net heat output, because J actually has those several parameters involved, like delta H, R, rho, Cp. So in fact, this is nothing but the heat that is taken out by the reactant stream from the fluid present in the reactor or liquid present in the reactor. That means this is the heat flow out from the system. This is also a heat flow out by the cooling coil or the cooling jacket. Now, what is the right hand term? Since these are the equality expressions, so this must balance each other. So whatever loss or heat loss from this side must be accompanied or must be compensated by this heat generation term. So X, though it is written in just this expression, but physically what do we mean? That the heat generation by the reaction, heat generation is the exothermic reaction, so heat generation by the reaction is basically compensating or just giving us the supply of heat which are basically used by this. So this equality expression holds true, and just knowing this physical meaning, we have just divided, or we have just what is called, we have just expressed it more explicitly, as you can see here, that X, which is a function of temperature, though it is written, it is not just a scalar quantity or just a constant value, this X, it is a function of temperature. And let us see what do they contain, what their function value contains. So if you just do a first order irreversible kinetics of this expression, then you get a conversion as a function of k and tau. So this is very much familiar to us. This you have already done it. In isothermal case, you didn't actually write this k as a function of temperature. You just wrote it as k tau by 1 plus k tau conversions. So what I want that instead of memorizing the formula, the first order conversions or the rate expressions, you derive it. You derive it from the governing equations, governing laws, so that you don't have to memorize, and you will not only for the first order case, but if it is a second order case, you can also analyze. In fact, this particular chapter at the end, there are several other type of reactions, like second order reactions or equilibrium reactions, for which the multiple steady state analysis can be carried out. Let me give an examples to you. Okay, now one of the research that is currently going on is basically the organic waste conversions. So these organic waste are typically being kept in a digester for bacteria and microbes to work on, and typically they are carried out in CSTR. So these CSTR operations, that means our target is to design the CSTR, not only the volume or the sizing of the reactor, but also the temperature and conversions that we are getting at the exit. So those are mildly exothermic, but they are isothermal reactions that will happen inside the reactor. And more importantly, there will be not a single reaction happening. There will be simultaneous several reactions that will happen in that digester. So invariably, this modeling of CSTR is required. And not only the nature of the solutions, whether we are getting stable steady state or unstable steady state, but also we have to find out the volume that is required for a given conversions, or for a given volume, how much conversions we are getting from that CSTR or the temperature. So this has bigger implications. So this topic is, of course, very, very important in that sense. So these expressions that we have now writing or trying to explain this term as a heat generation term. So where is that heat generation source is coming is basically from this K, because K is a function of temperature. Now we have written it as this two. This right side earlier was XT, and then we have just expressed it as K tau by 1 plus K tau. Now this expression, this K tau by 1 plus K tau, is it will generate as a sigmoidal curve. Sigmoidal curve means it initially the slope is small, then increases, then again get constant. So for smaller value of this temperature, because this is just a function of temperature, tau is constant. So at low temperature, it increases rapidly with temperature as K tau, as KT. So this is the lower side term, and this is the K tau equals to 1, this will be half. So somewhere it will be 0.5. And it will start from here actually. And this will be 1. At high enough temperature, this will be 1, because then this term will be omitted. So K tau and K tau, so it will be 1. So this is a sigmoidal curve. So this right hand side, which is representative as a generation term, heat generation term, we call is as a function of GT, right? And the left hand side, where the heat are getting taken away, or rather taken out from the system, that we are calling as heat or energy generation and energy consumption or energy loss. So removal term, right? So RT. So this RT and GT, these are actually equated, but both of them have temperature and conversions. So graphically, we will approach first. So what is the graphical approach? Graphical approach is you basically vary the temperature, you calculate this expression GT, and you also calculate the RT. and then plot together. So one is basically GT versus temperature. This will give us one line, and RT versus temperature. This will give us another line. So both of them can be plotted and can be looked at visually what they represent. So maybe just from the mathematical side, if you have f1 x equals to f2 x, then you are varying x to calculate both the functions, and where they will intersect, you are getting, or you are calling them as a solution of the equations, right? So in that circumstances, sometime you may have this kind of occurrence where this particular curve, that is f2, is intersecting f1 at three different locations, right? Now, mathematical point of view, maybe like this, you may discard the some other values, some other roots, x2, x3, you may discard, because that does not make physical sense, or they have occurred out of bound like that. But in case of this CSTR operations, and particularly we have simplified the case. Simplified the case means, now earlier we had this both the term. So this k into t minus tc, this is the heat taken away by the cooling coil or the jacket. So basically q term. So if we operate the reactor adiabatically, so this term actually goes off, right? So we just are left with t minus t0 by j. So this is the heat removal term. And this is the heat generation term, which is k tau by 1 plus k tau, as I showed that this is a sigmoidal curve. So basically you will have this kind of plot. Graphical analysis, you will land up first with these expressions, or with this kind of results. So both them are plotted as g and r, two functions. So this is nothing but the r functions, and this is nothing but the g functions. So again, so what is g? G, which is a function of temperature, it is just the k tau by 1 plus k tau. Tau is constant, k is a function of temperature. So for a series of values of temperature, let's say you have started from, let's say, 300 to 400 Kelvin, or more than that, 300, 400 centigrade maybe. So over that temperature, you are getting a series of G values, which you can plot, and you will get this kind of sigmoidal curve. And also you have the R of T, which is nothing but T minus T0 by J. So T0 is constant, J is also constant, and several values of T will give you this kind of linear lines, linear data points, which you can join, and you can get this kind of R. So this analysis now will be understood, will be explained to you, but an exercise problem will also be given to you for your practice. That means that propylene glycol case, or the manufacture of propylene glycol from propylene oxide and water, that will be given to you for your practice. So the first case can be like for a given T0 and for a given other parameters, let's say Ca naught, that is the inlet molar concentrations of the reactant. Then you have the volumetric flow rate. Not only the temperature at the reactor inlet, but these are other parameters. I'll tell you the exact reason why I have written these three parameter now here. So right now we are not telling about anything, what are the implications can have, but we are just starting it as, or we just accept the fact that we have started with some T0, we have started with some Ca0 and V0, which is constant over the CSTR. So G and R both are plotted, and they may intersect at this point. So we are happy that we have got only one, which we are calling it as steady state value. So we are still in the graphical analysis, but there may be a case where this linear line, that means the R functions, where the slope is nothing but 1 by J. So 1 by J slope will remain constant because J is constant, not having any temperature term. But if you vary the T0 little bit, That means the inlet reactor temperature, sorry, not reactor temperature, the stream that is entering the reactor, that the inlet temperature of the inlet stream, or input temperature of the inlet stream. So T0 can be varied little bit, so that we may shift the line little bit. Okay, so if we shift the line little bit, what will happen? What will happen, it may have intersected now this way. So remember, we didn't vary anything about G, because tau is constant. Temperature we have set up over some range, let's say 300 to 400 degree centigrade. But now for the second diagram, that is the second case, this diagram which we are now analyzing, we have slightly varied the T0, and that actually resulted to these three dots, that is T1, T2, T3. Okay, further varying this, we are getting again 1. That means what? There is something that is happening, peculiar behavior, right? So let us see whether they have occurred as what is called sporadically, or they have occurred just having some meaningful sense about their occurrence. Okay, so that means this, when as I said in the first, this mathematical, these two term expressions, f1x, when where they intersect, we get call it as a solution of those equations. So here we also call that this is a solution. So this is the steady state temperature, and if you put that in the expression of conversion, you will get the steady state conversion. So we are happy, but here there are three. So the questions that again, so at least now we have understood that there is an occurrence that a reactor can have a single steady state, can have multiple steady state. This is called actually multiplicity of steady states. Now, whether we will consider all the steady state, or what is that, or indirectly, or if we put it in this way, that at what steady state we should operate the reactor, so that we are safe, we don't encounter any thermal runaway, right? So this is very much important in terms of design and operational point of view of a CSTR, where typically non-isothermal reactions are carried out. So let us now further go ahead and graphically understand that, characterize them, characterizing each of the steady state. Okay, for that I will now go to the different slides, a different book chapter, to clearly explain you this thing. Let's say these three, because this again, we can write it as, this is our R, the heat removal line, and this is our generated line. So it is written here over different color code. I have still written for the sake of clarity. Now let us understand that we have seen that this is one steady state point, this is one route, this is another route. So each one of them can be characterized. How? Let's say, suppose you are operating the reactor at this steady state value, right? At this steady state value, you are operating the reactor, and you have by some disturbance, by some operational fault, the temperature little bit increased. So temperature little bit increased. So now the temperature is somewhere in this zone, maybe. Okay. So at this zone, what is which one dominates? The heat absorbed term dominates, right? So heat absorption or heat removal, that means RT is dominating over GT. So this is more. So this will cause the temperature again to come down. So even if your temperature has changed slightly from steady state value due to some disturbance, due to some process fault, or due to some operational difficulty, but you are still safe. That means you are you are not landing up with another different steady state point, or you are not operating it in a unstable manner. So again, if some slight changes causes the temperature to again get restored back to its previous points. Tick. Again, if that is the one side of the story. That is the second side of the story, is that if the temperature, instead of increasing, let's say it has decreased slightly, Now what happens? You can see that heat generated term is more. That means it will increase the temperature further. Heat will generate more, so temperature will increase. That will again cause the whatever drop in temperature happened, it will again restore it back to its previous point. That means point A. So we are safe. That means this steady state point, if we operate the reactor at this steady state point, then we actually are safe. We don't are running away. That means since these are basically heat removal and heat generation simultaneously present, so we are these are not taking away our temperature. These are not causing the temperature to drift from the this steady state point. So this steady state point is called stable steady state point. That means you are able to operate the reactor at this point very much stable manner. You are not having any difficulty. Okay, so this is the one analysis point of view. So one way we understood that, first we understood that multiplicity of steady state occur. Second, we are understanding that there can be what is called from the graphical point of view about characterizing the steady states, whether we accept them, or even if we accept all them, all the steady state, but are we safe in operating the reactor at each of the steady state. So the first part of the roots, or first root, if we analyzed, then graphically we understood that if we are drifting away from the steady state temperature, but still we are safe because our heat generation term and heat removal term are so that we again are restoring back the temperature. So this actually tells us that reactor is operated very stable manner. Now go back to the C point. Okay, so A point is clear. Go back to the C point. So in the C point, if you analyze in the same way, you will again see that heat removal is dominating if you increase the temperature. So heat removal means the heat will be taken out, so temperature will again come down, temperature will drop again back to C. And if you are drifting lower value to this steady state temperature, then heat generation will more, so it will add up some heat, temperature will increase, that will again restore back. So point A and point C, they are steady state points where if you operate the reactor, then they will operate, or reactor will be operated in a safe and stable manner. You will even slight variation in temperature occurs, it is capable enough to restore the temperature, or it is capable enough to come back to its previous steady state temperature. No new steady state is required, or no transient occurrence is there. So transient occurrence are when basically you have two different steady states. So between two different steady states, you actually have transients. That means the time effects are on the temperature or on the conversions. So any transient analysis that we do, sometimes we just write it as an accumulation term in zero and we are operating at steady state. That means we have considered that, or we are in the vicinity of that steady state, or we are actually working on that steady state, right? But typically we have to always consider the transient phenomena or transient part. And we have to see that in the effect of long run, that means in the effect of long, after long enough time, what is the behavior. So sometimes we in the process control or process dynamics case subject, we have considered that after T infinite, we have to see that ultimate steady state value. So this is very much important statement that between two steady state, you actually have transient states. You have transient phenomena, but this transient phenomena that we are calling here, that if slight variation of temperature occurs, it again restores back. So that means these transients are very weak. So it's almost like quickly it takes you to the previous steady state. But for now, consider this B point. Okay, so A and C point are stable steady state. We write it as stable steady state. So what about B? Can any one of you analyze the way I am analyzing the A and C? Can you tell what is the nature of B, whether it is a stable or unstable steady state?
Unstable.
Why?
If we increase the temperature, heat generation is more, so keep increasing.
Very good. So we got that B is unstable, A and C are very much stable. Now the intriguing questions, very tricky question. Are we operating the reactor at, or where do we like to operate the reactor? If we ask this question, where you would like to operate the reactor? At what steady point? At which steady state point? Where you would? Oh, sorry. I think I've done some mistake. Cancel will close it. No, fine. Save. Where? Basically, I'm asking where you would like to operate the reactor. At around which steady state point? Where you would operate the reactor?
Around A.
Okay, let us get the opinion around A. Others? A, B, or C? How many of you are in the opinion of the reactor should be operated at A? Do all of you agree that reactor should be operated at A? Sneha Bandhu is agreeing. Okay, let me ask you, how many of you are in the opinion that reactor should be operated in at the point B? What will happen if the reactor is operated at B?
It will either go to C or A, like the next steady state.
Right. But why we are not interested, or rather let me ask you that though A and C are stable, but it is not operated at A and stable, A and C point. Though the steady states are stable, but typically the operation is not carried out around, or the reactor is not operated at A and C point. Can you guess? Can you see? Can you tell the implications of that? See, all in industrial, these productions of the, let's say, this propylene glycol, or this is a one case. I mean, there are several reactions. In fact, this is a single reaction that we are talking about, A going to R, or let's say propylene oxide and water goes to propylene glycol. But there will be, in industry, you will have several reactions occurring together. So selectivity is an issue, okay? Selectivity of components. Not only the selectivity, the yield that the operator or that particular plant, they will decide. They may not be yielding, or they may not be producing that component very much, but they are trying to produce it very selectively. So when we say very selectively, then temperature is an issue, because at high temperature some other side reaction may occur. So the desired product's yield or productivity or the rate is not there. Though the overall rate of the reaction increases because temperature increases, ideally one would like to operate at C, right? Because C is a stable point. C is also a point where temperature is high. So rate of the reaction will be very high. Productivity will be high. But there are selectivity issues. There are desired component which might be produced at a temperature very nearly to B. So this is the window where you will see that reactor, where we will see that more of the desired product is produced around the point B. So we have to somehow make an amendment, kind of, I'm trying to make you physically explaining that, make a kind of arrangement, or correct this point B. But we will not be able to correct it by virtue of anything, like it is inherently, it is unstable. So then we actually go for control devices or control strategy. We have to make use of controller. We have to make use of what is called arrangements, where we can slide variations. We should have a control. So controller actions. This is actually then this actually leads us to further go to that design of controller, temperature and flow controller. So in fact, people actually do that, and this is the way to get rid of this difficulty. We should be operating, or rather, not only should be, but if your product the demands show, so that it is basically a desired product, and the temperature range it is being produced is actually lying in the vicinity of B. So you cannot omit or you cannot disagree this B point. You have to operate the reactor at B point, but you also know that slight variation will land up you to at point A or point C. Now point C is a point where rate may be very high, but your desired product yield is low. Point A is overall rate of the reaction is so low because it is a temperature is very less, rate will be not very high. So sometimes or rather most of the time, the reactor has to be operated near the point of B. So you have to operate at point B, but you have to also ensure that slight variation of temperature should not take you or should not take you to the point C or point A. So you have to go for making a flow controller or temperature controller, and that to be also implemented or plugged up on in the reactor or along with the reactor, so that we can take the advantage of making the desired product in a large proportion, because the temperature, maybe it is a very high temperature sensitive material. At high temperature, it may not sustain, though the rate is high. So you have to operate at B. So this is the beauty that of knowing the different steady states. And in apparently, it may look like that we are welcoming some difficult situations, but actually that is helping us in terms of getting a desired product. So in that way, our analysis must be carried out. And as I said, in fact, I'll give you the questions in the TAN projects is such that you have to take up this kind of problem. In fact, the organic waste conversions using anaerobic digester, which is nothing but a CSTR, where multiple steady state can occur. It cannot occur, it can occur. So what are the factors that actually governs them? Little bit understanding you have already got or understood that if you vary the T0, that is the feed inlet temperature, that may result into different behavior. Sometimes the single steady state is not useful. Higher is also maybe difficult or maybe not advantageous. So somewhere in the middle is the optimum line, considering the fact that your desired product forms selectively in high proportion, or at least in that temperature, because no single reaction occur in these multiple steady state operations in industry. There are actually simultaneous reactions, several reactions, not just one. So considering the fact that selectivity, you may have to operate at point B, which is unstable, but you have to have some additional strategies in hand so that operation remains unaltered or operation is not affected. So apart from T0, this initial concentrations and sometimes the volumetric flow rate values may affect, so that we get a multiple steady state. The mathematical part I will leave it now, because it again I'll incorporate some more examples in this case, and where I will actually wanted to discuss that linearization of equations, where we actually can analyze the stability of steady state. Till now we have understood the stability through graphical sense, through physical understanding, but from mathematical perspective that is also possible to calculate the eigenvalue of the linearization equations. So this I will discuss in the next class, along with one more example, so that you can also understand that in terms of this behavior. So the temperature or concentrations, they may rise up, they may shoot up, they may, so this is going to that A point, this is going to the C point, this may in the B point, but A, no, sorry. This is basically slight variation will around the B point will tell you to, take us to the C or A. But if you want to have a controller in actions, that depending on the controller tuning and parameter, this may be a damped oscillations, there may be oscillations, or it may if it is a very good PID controller, then it may tell you take us to that actual steady state or the in the it will help us to operate in the B point. Mm. So this I will explain in the next class by looking at the eigenvalues along with some more examples. So this mathematical part, I'll leave it now. And what I wanted to finally show is that where you can actually also vary the other parameters. So not only the feed temperature, but also you can attain multiple steady state by varying the volumetric flow rate and CA naught. Okay, so this is one case where you can see that varying the CA naught, we have got the different lines, that means different R lines. These linear lines are nothing but R lines, right? And if you remember the R term, this must be containing the term of CA naught. So this T minus T naught we are writing as K, and this I think J has this CA naught. So T minus T naught by J. So the slope, yes. So the in first case we varied the intercept, keeping the slope constant. So the line actually slide like this. But now we are varying the slope, so it may go like this, and sometimes it can cut that sigmoidal line in three different cases. So basically by varying the CA naught, we are varying the J, keeping T0 constant. So this effect of several other parameters are very important, not only the feed temperature, but also the inlet concentration, as well as the volumetric rate. So here one case they have actually showed here that by varying the CA naught, so here you can see that slope actually changes. That means this slope of this R term, which is nothing but 1 by J, this is the slope. So by varying CA naught, we are actually varying the R lines. And somewhere it has cut once, somewhere it, so here just for example, it has cut once. Here it has cut thrice, here, here, and here. This line has cut twice. Oh, this is also has cut thrice. So either one or three, these two cases actually occur. So this is very interesting. I mean, these examples or this particular statement, I will write it separately, I mean, and send you as a practice problem, which you can try and you can see how many points it is actually getting cut. And if you can vary the parameters like T naught or CA naught, you can see the effects on the behavior of the multiple steady states. So this is very important. This will not only help you to understand the concept, but if you can practice this kind of questions, the TAN projects will be very much easy for you. So this was the content of today's discussion, and study materials will be shared, but the mathematical part is left behind, which will combine with one more examples from some other case, not just a reactor case, but some other different operations. So these two together I will discuss in the next class, and then we will proceed for differential equations or some other new topic. Okay, any doubts, or if you have learned something on that? this book chapter is I will be sharing this week study material along with yesterday's notes. Any doubts so far? Are there any doubts? Or do you want to first read and then in the next class, if you have doubts, you will ask.
That is good.
Okay, so should I send the numerical questions as well for your practice? That propylene glycol or some other numerical problem? Because if you have the data available with you, you might be interested to plot it. T term, J term, G term, R term, 1 by J slope. So I might be giving one problem along with some data about the rate of reaction, heat of reactions, Ca naught, T naught. This data, if it is available to you, then you might be interested to work it on analytically and see the values, nature of the plots. Mm.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I'll combine both of them and I'll. Okay, then if no questions, then we again meet next week to finish the discussion part of this stability and linearization. Okay, thank you all.
हेलो सर,